Welcome to worship at Prince of Peace Lutheran Church in beautiful Burnsville, Minnesota. We are so glad that you're here today. And regardless of where we are on our spiritual journey, everyone is welcome here with us. And we look forward to joining together in our online worship. And hopefully in the coming months, we'll be back together again. My name is Mark Slaughter, and I'm joined today with Pastor Paul Gaucher, and together with a bunch of amazing other people. It is our joy to be with you in worship. Today we're going to take some time to celebrate our freedom as Americans, but we will also take some time to pray for our country, which is going through a very difficult season right now. The phrase freedom and justice for all, it really has been challenged this year as we've witnessed and we've heard from people of color that freedom and certainly justice has not been experienced. Oppression, profiling, and a failure to hear the stories of pain too often has scarred the heart of this country and created division and an unwillingness to listen to one another. So today, we still want to acknowledge that amidst the challenges of our country, that life, liberty, and justice for all are still values that we aspire to embrace. We believe that God has called us to embrace these values as we are called to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. And we must remember that as the Church of Jesus Christ, we are not God's chosen people by virtue of citizenship, birthright, or race. But as recorded in the words of 1 Peter, he says, "But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God." We are a people belonging to God because we are all chosen by God. So today, as we worship, may we understand the words of the hymn writer, "America, America, God shed his grace on thee." And as our need for the power of God's Spirit to open the hearts of all people to have grace for each other and for every one of us, to come together to love one another and to join in worship of our Creator God.
Amen. Please join me as I guide our prayer. Creator God, we thank you for this day, and we humbly come to you today as we are joined together. Even though we're distant apart, we are unified by your Holy Spirit. And so we humbly come to you today and confess that we, especially as Americans, have not lived into the ideals that we proclaim. So we pray that you would forgive us and help us to seek and demonstrate justice for all people here in America and all over the world. Let us confess how we have often lived according to our fears, building walls that separate us from one another. Let us confess when we have not taken the time to listen deeply to the wounds and pain of one another. We confess the times when we have been heavy on judgment and short on compassion and focused on the sins of others, spending less time in our own confession. So as we confess, we ask for your forgiveness and we seek your help for a clear understanding and better direction to know how we can bring justice and liberty for all. And as I stand here in front of our state capitol, please join me in praying for everything that happens within these walls. Pray that the love of God and the justice for all people would be evident, acknowledged, and taken steps to allow it more and more. Pray now for our political leaders in each state, in this state, that we would work diligently to promote unity, justice, and liberty for every person and all of creation. God, we pray that we would do our part to elect such leaders and fight for policies, laws, and programs that bring freedom amidst oppression, dismantle racism, and promote the good of all people. So God, that we pray that you would help us to be more faithful in taking more steps into your vision from the prophet Isaiah to bring about a new heaven and a new earth. And we pray all this by the power of Jesus' name, who led us to pray in this way. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
All I want, all I need, more of you, less of me. Take this life, Lord, it's yours. My heart, have it all.
When I was a kid, every school day started the same way, with the Pledge of Allegiance. We got out of our desks, we stood next to them, put our hands over our hearts, and we said it. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. You know, there was just something about that last line, with liberty and justice for all. Maybe it was because we said it every day for years on end. Maybe it was because there was some poetry or rhythm or rhyme to it that I didn't get, but that it got me. I mean, those words, with liberty and justice for all, were poured into me so many times. I had no idea what they meant. I had no idea what they looked like in my life. I didn't know what they didn't look like in the lives of other people. I was growing up insulated. I had no idea what it meant to be Black, Brown, Indigenous, Latinx, person of color. And because I never had to question what it meant to have liberty and justice for all, I never gave it a second thought. Until my dad came home from an Elks Club meeting. I was in the fifth grade. I was about 11 years old when my dad came home from an Elks Club meeting, and he was visibly irritated. A friend of our family's, a member of our church, a good friend of my dad's, wasn't able to join the Elks Club. I mean, my dad could join, but my dad's friend wasn't able to join. And I remember when I asked my dad why he wasn't able to join, my dad's response was so odd. He said, because he's Black. Now, I don't remember much else from that conversation, but I do remember the anger and the frustration on my dad's face. And I do remember the confusion I felt about because he's Black would be a reason for anyone anywhere not to be part of anything. As an 11-year-old kid, it was kind of like saying you couldn't be part of my tree fort club because your shoes weren't the right brand. Wait, what? We are wrapping up our 4-week worship series that we've called Won't You Be My Neighbor. Pastor Jeff began by challenging us to think about neighbor the way Jesus thought about neighbor, not in geographical terms, but in relational terms, so that our neighbor is the person before us in need, and to be a neighbor is to meet the needs of those who have them. Jason Cramey was next, and he talked about how seeking justice for our neighbors doesn't mean just confronting the issues that keep us apart, but actively dismantling the systems that favor whites, that hinder people of color, and then going a step further in creating a new world where liberty and justice for all is for all people. And then last week, Pastor Sandy gave us some great insight into the hard work, the long haul work of reconciliation. On this July 4th weekend, we're celebrating our nation's independence. We're celebrating our freedom. This is the 244th birthday of our country that was built on truths that we hold to be self-evident, that all people are created equal, and that we are endowed by our Creator with certain unalienable rights, among them life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Having escaped oppression, the framers of the Constitution, including Thomas Jefferson, the author of the Declaration of Independence, who was deeply flawed when it came to matters of race, nevertheless cast a stunning vision for this new nation, a vision of which we have fallen short. But friends, on this July 4th weekend, we acknowledge that the 244-year-old vision for this nation is eclipsed by a far more ancient, even more compelling vision for the entire planet. It's a vision that God has called the human family to embrace. A vision of a world where liberty and justice for all means liberty and justice for all. On this Independence Weekend, we come together as a community of faith to commit ourselves, to recommit ourselves to making the vision of liberty and justice for all a reality on earth as it is in heaven. In Isaiah 65, the prophet Isaiah speaks the words of God to a nation of people who have lost the plot. They've gone their own way. They've done their own thing. They have not been faithful to God's dream of liberty and justice for all people. However, there's a remnant. There is a small neighborhood, if you will, a neighborhood of faithful followers who do desire to live into God's original dream and to actively work toward that vision for liberty and justice for all people, no exceptions. And so through Isaiah, God calls all people to this vision for a new world and invites all people to become part of that neighborhood. So here's the vision from Isaiah 65. Pay close attention now. I'm creating new heavens and a new earth. All the earlier troubles, chaos, and pain are things of the past to be forgotten. Look ahead with joy. Anticipate what I'm creating. I'll create Jerusalem as sheer joy. Create my people as pure delight. I'll take joy in Jerusalem, take delight in my people. No more sounds of weeping in the city, no more cries of anguish, no more babies dying in the cradle, or old people who don't enjoy a full lifetime. 100 birthdays will be considered normal. Anything less will seem like a cheat. They'll build houses and move in. They'll plant fields and eat what they grow. No more building a house that some outsider takes over. No more planting fields that some enemy confiscates. For my people will be as long-lived as trees. My chosen ones will have satisfaction in their work. They won't work and have nothing come of it. They won't have children snatched out from under them. For they themselves are plantings blessed by God, with their children and grandchildren likewise God blessed. Before they call out, I'll answer. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Friends, I have to tell you that when I read this passage in the context of this weekend, it occurred to me that this is God's pledge of allegiance to us, to the entire human family. This is God's pledge, God's promise to make all things new. This is God's pledge, God's promise to those who do not experience justice or live in freedom, that justice and freedom will prevail. This is God's pledge, God's promise to those whose dreams of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness have been stolen by some other vision. Just days after George Floyd was killed in this very place, in this very intersection of 38th and Chicago in Minneapolis, Nancy Lee and I spent some time trying to come to grips with the profound tragedy of what happened right here on the evening of May 25th, 2020. But not only what happened here on a particular spot, on a particular date to a particular man, but really what has taken place in countless places, countless times, to countless numbers of people of color throughout our history. Standing in this intersection reminds me that we, all of us together as one human family, are standing in the intersection between where we've been and where we're going. The real power of Isaiah 65 is that it reminds us that God is always up to something, always up to something new, something bold, something different, something life-giving for all people everywhere. That's the very heart and core of the gospel. But friends, the question is simply this. Are we willing to partner with God? Are we willing to stand with our brothers and sisters of every tribe and nation to make God's new vision for a new world a new reality? Or aren't we? Whenever we encounter a passage like the one from Isaiah 65, we're asking two questions. The first question is, what does it say? Well, we know what it says. I just read it a few moments ago. It says that God is creating new heavens and a new earth. And all the earlier troubles, the chaos, the pain will be forgotten. No more sounds of weeping in the city, no more cries of anguish. That's what it says. But the second question is far more compelling and powerful. The second question is this: what's it saying? How is this passage still speaking? Maybe even more specifically, what are these words saying to us in this current moment in time? Friends, Isaiah 65 is saying that we're standing in the intersection between the old world of oppression and injustice and the new world where there is liberty and justice for all. What does that new world look like? Isaiah gives us a picture of the new world where all people can expect justice, equality, equity, fairness, peace, safety, and dignity. God's vision is of a community where, as it says in verse 20, 100th birthdays will be considered normal. Anything else will seem like a cheat. I imagine God's heart breaking as George Floyd cried out just a few feet from here, "Please, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. My stomach hurts. My neck hurts. Everything hurts. Some water or something. Mama, I can't move. They're going to kill me." The heartbreaking truth, friends, is that George Floyd was cheated out of his 47th birthday. And as a result of every birthday after that, God says, "No more, not in my new world." Liberty and justice for all is part of the new heavens and the new earth that God is announcing in Isaiah 65. God is calling us into the intersection between the old world of oppression and injustice and into the new world where there is liberty and justice for all. What does that new world look like? It looks like the young white woman who, protesting injustice and racism, holds the sign which reads, "I see you. I hear you. I see the injustice that you face. I mourn with you. I may never understand 100%, but I will stand with you always." Liberty and justice for all is part of the new heavens and the new earth that God announces in Isaiah 65. God is calling us into the intersection between injustice and oppression and the new world where there is liberty and justice for all. What does that look like? Well, it looks like the little girl holding the sign which reads, "We said Black Lives Matter. We never said only Black Lives Matter. We know all lives matter. We just need your help with Black Lives Matter because Black lives are in danger." Friends, God's new world is a place of joy and delight where there are no more sounds of weeping in the city, no more sounds of anguish in the night. And that world begins to come into focus. It begins to be birthed among us when we stop arguing about whose lives matter most, which is an exercise in missing the point. Because all lives matter, every man, woman, and child created in the image of God, all lives can't matter until Black lives matter, because for far too long we've all lived like they haven't mattered. God's new world looks like the kind of community that steps into the intersection of liberty and justice for all and says that no mother, no father, no grandma, no grandpa, no son or daughter, no spouse or loved one will ever have to worry if their loved one will make it home safely that night. God's new world looks like the kind of community that walks into the intersection of liberty and justice for all and says no one will ever be denied anything based on the color of their skin, but instead be a blessing to the world around them based on the content of their character, and where all people agree to stand together and pledge allegiance to liberty and justice for all people, no exceptions. Well, friends, I want to step into that intersection, and I'm wondering if you'll step into that intersection with me. Will you step into the intersection where we join our hearts and our hands together as we sing that that spiritual, we shall overcome someday. Will you step into the intersection with me? As together we join our hands and we sing with all our hearts, we shall overcome someday. Will you join your hearts and hands and your lives together with me so that together we can sing that song of God's justice, God's mercy, God's love, where there is liberty and justice for all.
We'll walk hand in hand. We'll walk hand in hand. We'll walk hand. Someday.
We shall overcome. Those are powerful words. Words can be very powerful as they move us to make changes, as they move us to know that we are loved and we are forgiven and that we can move forward. Jesus gives us that promise through the powerful words of Holy Communion. And so Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread and he gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks. And he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. And now, as you share Holy Communion with those who are around you, you simply take the bread and hand it to the person who's near you and say, "This is the body of Christ given for you and for all people." And then take the cup and say, "This is the blood of Christ shed for you and for all people."
Brothers and sisters in Christ, centuries ago, God spoke this dream, this vision for new heavens and a new earth, where the earlier troubles, the chaos, and the pain will be forgotten. That vision speaks deeply to my heart. And I want to do what I can to make God's vision our vision together. My fear, of course, is that I'll forget Isaiah. I'll forget God's vision. I'll forget George Floyd. God forbid that I should forget. So I'm asking you to help me not forget. And I'm asking you to let me help you not forget. I'm asking you to take just one step today to make liberty and justice for all a reality on earth as it is in heaven. You can check any of the resources that we've made available on our website. Join a small group to read about and talk about the changes that we can all make to hasten God's dream for liberty and justice for all people everywhere, no exceptions. So, brothers and sisters in Christ, may you step into the intersection of liberty and justice for all so that God's love, God's justice, God's compassion can flow through you to your neighbor, the person before you in need. May you step into the intersection of liberty and justice for all so that by being equipped with the Spirit, you can seek justice for all people by both confronting and actively dismantling systems that favor some and hinder others from experiencing life and more life. May you step into the intersection of liberty and justice for all, where we engage the long-haul work of reconciliation. And may you step into the intersection of liberty and justice for all, where God's vision for new heavens and a new earth emerges through you, beginning right here, right now. So let's go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Spirit, I want. Christians